Welcome to Real Time, Florida Sportsman. This week, we're in Marco Island. We're fishing for snook and tarpon.
It's time to find the shortest route to the hottest bite. We scan Florida Sportsman's regional forums for the best fishing reports, then travel to make real anglers our local guides.
Give me some of that!
Together, we let you in on secret spots and hometown moves.
That's what I'm talking about!
Oh, yeah. She's done for now.
This week we're in Marco Island. We're fishing the 10,000 Island section of the Florida Sportsman Forum, and we're fishing what this area is famous for, snook and tarpon.
Oh! It's a, told you there were some good snook around here.
Buddy.
Here he comes, coming up.
That a baby.
All coming up on Real Time, Florida Sportsman.
We started the morning by meeting this week's guest host, John Derrig, and his buddy Bill Jones at the boat ramp. All right, man, this is my first time to Marco Island. This place is absolutely incredible. What a morning.
Yeah, it's paradise.
What do you got planned for us?
Yeah, we're gonna run around the corner up here, just take a quick right, throw the net a couple times, get some bait, and then we're gonna run south.
Down to the 10,000 Islands?
Yeah.
All right, we got Bill. Bill, you've been here a while, John, yeah. So we're gonna, I don't know, put a hurting on him. We got some bird activity. Big full moon again. It seems like every time I go someplace, I land on a full moon. Just my timing, but hopefully the bite happens today. The first task of the morning was to head over and load up the live wells full of white bait. Now this place is loaded with bait. A couple throws of the net, and we had that Triton's live well blacked out. You know, it's kind of wild, you know, out here getting bait. We're sitting out in front of these giant condominiums, you know, but know that we're at the northern end of the 10,000 Islands. South of here, there's really not much. I mean, and that's what's probably so neat about this area. If you want to come into a developed area with beautiful resorts and just a beautiful town, you know, but at the same time, be able to get away and get back into the Everglades, what it truly probably looked like 200 years ago, this is the place to come. I mean, you can run just 10 minutes south of here and you won't see a soul all day long, and you can easily get lost in these mangrove shorelines. After we got bait, we had a short run to the first spot that John wanted to stop at. All right, John, first thing here, Marco Island, JD staying in the 10,000 Island section of Florida Sportsman Forum. Pretty much hitting all these cuts. We got chum first thing in the morning, white baits.
Yeah, we're just gonna go down here. We're gonna fish these shorelines, you know, catch some snook and stuff and start heading south.
Just hit every spot and they chum the crap out of all these spots.
Yeah, and then you just throw your line in and
see what happens. We got your buddy Bill out with us today. Hopefully we're gonna destroy him. We're coming off a big moon last night. It seems like every time I go somewhere, I'm fishing on a full moon, which is not ever the best thing, but hopefully we can put a hurting on him. Where are these fish gonna be, Bill? They're gonna be tight on that shore, or they're gonna be on that drop-off right there?
They're gonna be on the drop-off with this low tide. They'll move up. The tide starts running harder, but right now, about 20 feet off the shore, it drops a little bit deeper. That's where they should be at.
But when that tide pulls up, they get right on
that
undercut.
They get right underneath all that undercut.
Man, you can really see it now.
You see, if you look all the way around the edge, you'll see,
you can see
where the leaves
defined.
Stop.
Yeah.
Where they stop is high tide.
Wow.
So the snook, once tide gets here, will be 50, 60, 100 feet back into those roots. I saw him pop a minnow down there, so I just flipped another one behind him.
You just flipped his mullet minnow at me. Little males, huh? I get a lot of those around here.
Well, see, we had that freeze. This is the average size we're catching now since then. We're either catching them way over the slot or this size.
Way over is okay by me.
Yeah.
What's your slot over here? Same as ours, 28-32?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. 28-33.
Oh, wow, you guys got a little more room.
Yeah.
Doing surgery.
Oh, no, we're not killing him. Alexis would shoot me.
Who's Alexis?
Alexis is a state biologist in charge of snook research. We fill out log books for her. And
oh, really? You keep track of how many you catch?
Yeah. The size. What the water temperature was, the date. Same thing we do with the tarpon, except we take the genetic samples on the tarpon.
I'm all jacked up. Can't get away from these things this morning, boy. You know, pulling up to this first spot, throwing some baits in there, we were just inundated with jacks. You know, after a while, we had enough of that, we decided to move on to the next spot. This is kind of just what I was saying. You know, one second you're fishing, you know, the Everglades as you know it, mangrove line shorelines. The next minute, just a couple minutes away, I'm fishing this residential area, these residential canals. But you know, talking to Bill and John, they said this is where the fish have been. We're gonna give it a shot and try to get some snook here.
This segment brought to you by Raymarine Marine Electronics. Take the easy route with Raymarine.
When you fish competitively for a living, you need sonar you can trust.
I switched to Raymarine Chirp sonar to give me incredible underwater vision.
I switched to Raymarine Chirp sonar to see structure so sharp and fish targets so clear, it's like reality.
So don't lose faith in your sonar again.
Make the switch to Chirp and Raymarine Visionality and see the real world below.
All right, so we switched up a little bit, waiting for that tide to fill in the backcountry, right?
Yeah.
Get some residential docks. You said there's some snook along these walls.
Yeah, there's snook. There's all sorts of fish around here. Seeing them popping.
So deep water there, just gonna toss up along these walls. This is more what I'm used to type of snook fishing, not that backcountry stuff. But you need a lot of water back there. I think that's what's so neat about this area is you have these residential, you know, areas, but then you go 10 minutes down in that backcountry, it looks like Florida looked 200 years ago.
Yeah,
it's kind of neat that you can do these different types of things here, different types of fishery.
Yeah, it makes it nice, so you don't have to, sometimes if you don't have time during the day, you can just go out, hit some docks real quick, catch some fish, and go to work.
The cool thing about this particular spot is we're just right inside of Caxambas Pass. I mean, this is a residential area. You know, the Gulf of Mexico is just a stone's throw away. You got nice, fresh, clean water. The tide's coming in, the bait's moving in, and the fish are in this area.
A bit?
Yeah.
What you got there, buddy?
Nice. Decent little snook there.
Mm-hmm.
Good job. Came up and ate that white bait right off that rock fall. So that's a, you know, little guy, but mm-hmm. You say you get 40 inches in here.
Yeah, there's some nice ones that hang around these rocks.
You know, we pulled up to the seawall where Bill kind of suggested that we go. He said he'd been getting some snook around here. You know, and the first order of business is to throw a handful of chummers in there. And these guys do this kind of fire the fish up. And let me tell you what, it worked. These fish were going off. These little guys are, they're fun. God, these little guys are spunky in here. I think we found the nursery of snook. That's actually a little better there. Getting up close to slot. Here we go. Oh, this place is just loaded with these juvenile snook. You got yours in your hand there. I got one on. The tarpon just busted back here.
Right beside him. It's pretty.
Yeah, a little juvenile male, man. This place is loaded with those things right now. You know, so we landed in a little hot spot here. You can tell that this is the area. I always tell people, you find structure, you find current, you find bait, and you're gonna find the fish. And this spot had it all. There was mullet swimming by. Every time the mullet swim by, they were getting blown up by snook and tarpon, you know, and the current was ripping. And these rock piles, this is what snook love. They love this structure, these docks, these rocks. We're in a perfect spot. Watch to me.
Yeah.
God.
Now we're happy to see all these little fish coming back.
This is
after
actually
after that freeze.
This one doesn't even know he's hooked. There, he was around his gill. He was acting funny or something. He's just kind of one of the little bigger ones in here.
Yeah.
So that freeze really kind of affected you guys.
It affected us more from here to halfway through Everglades National Park. It just wiped out everything.
Really? But they're really making a comeback. I mean, you can just see here, they've opened up your season now. This is a nice quality snook.
Yes, it is.
I got this light leader on. I got to baby him. Just using 30-pound fluoro. Bill, would you mind?
Not at all.
There it is. I got him up in the corner now. And you really feel him in that tide. Oh, that's probably a keeper snook.
It is, I think.
Pretty fish. That's probably 28.
Yep.
Close to it.
Mm-hmm.
They got cooker catch where we're staying, but you know what? I can't do it on this coast. These guys are just making their comeback, and I got to let him get back in the water.
Yes. She might change sexes this winter and breed next year.
So this area is kind of cool. You know, a lot of times you get into one area and it's the same size fish, but it really wasn't the case here. You could tell that this area was going to hold some bigger fish. We were getting some smaller males, but every now and then you would get a decent, you know, nice near slot or slot fish.
Oh, well, that's a decent fish.
Good size.
You know, 15 pound spider wire. Tell you, this light tackle back in here, flipping these baits under there.
He's pretty.
That is fun.
Real clean.
Nice. You know, a great thing about this area is that we could sit here and we were really waiting for some tidal movement. It's real tidal dependent in the backcountry. You know, it's kind of low water first thing in the morning. We had all caught some great snook here, you know, kept busy, but really we had enough water now to make the move, head back into the backcountry.
This segment is brought to you by PowerPole, swift, silent, secure.
C.A. Richardson here for PowerPole, where every shallow water anchor is designed and tested to be extremely quiet. How quiet? Let's take a look. Hey guys. Great work, guys.
Don't slam the door.
PowerPole, deadly silent to help you catch more fish.
All right, so we're gonna change gears, leaving those snook behind, the residential area that, you know, I'm kind of used to. This is something that I'm not used to, this mangrove, you know, this 10,000 islands, it gets its name because there are probably 10,000 islands. And Marco Island, you were telling me, it's like the biggest of the 10,000 islands.
Yeah, that's correct. Marco is the biggest, and we're gonna start running south and fishing a lot of mangrove shorelines and stuff like that and see if we can catch some fish.
You know, we've done shows down in Everglades City, Chokoloskee, you know, but we're 10 minutes outside of Marco Island, kind of developed area, and this all looks exactly the same as the heart of the Everglades. This is what you think of when you're fishing these 10,000 islands. It's just mangrove line, beautiful shorelines, undercut ambush points. You know, this is why we came to this area. I'm doing it a little different, you know. I'm just sitting here plugging on the shoreline with this gull. Keep skipping in, covering a lot of water.
You know, it doesn't take live bait. They love the gulp.
And I can cover a lot of water with the gulp. You can hit every spot. It's a great thing. It does require some accuracy on your casting, but when you rig it weedless, you get some forgiveness. You know, we had a little window in there for the right tidal height. You know, not enough water, they can't get up along the mangroves, they're sitting in the deeper holes. Too much water, you know, and they're flooded way back in these mangroves. And kind of, all of a sudden there was too much water and these fish were way back in the mangroves and we just weren't getting the bite. We started talking amongst ourselves and we decided, you know, why did we leave fish to find fish? We knew we had a great morning bite going. We decided to make the run back to the residential area and see if that bite picked back up. You know, what we had noticed in the morning was every time a mullet school went by, it was getting blown up by tarpon and big tarpon. You know, they were sitting out a little further than the snook. They wanted nothing to do with the white bait, but every time a mullet went by, it was getting crashed. You know, we decided, how about we put some time in and look for one of those big tarpon? We were in here this morning, and this is where we caught all those snook, and we saw some tarpon rolling, so decided to make our way back in here, netted some big mullet, and when I tell you these are big mullet, most people at home wouldn't use a mullet like that, but this is what these tarpon are eating in here, just big old trocar circle hook. Just gonna hook them in the nose, 80 pound fluorocarbon leader, big old circle hook, and all we're gonna do is float them out the back. And this is probably one of the best ways to fish them in current like this. Loosen the drags a little bit. We're just gonna let them sit in a rod holder. And I tell you what, that rod holder's gonna set the hook more times than not. You know, it didn't take long, maybe 10 or 15 minutes with those mullets sitting back there in that, you know, that perfect area. And the next thing you know, that tarpon was airborne. God! We saw these fish sitting in here this morning. Came in here, I swear to God, with a 2 pound silver mullet on a circle hook. And he just came up and waylaid this thing. Here he comes, coming up.
That a baby.
Woo-hoo! I tell you, man, we came in here first thing this morning. We caught some snook. We saw these tarpon in here rolling. We went back down south looking for redfish. Had a tough day on the full moon. We said, you know what, let's go back in there, try to get one of those tarpon. And we've been sitting here for about 10, 15 minutes with two mullet out the back on big circle hooks.
Yeah, baby, that was perfect.
This is a big fish, you know, this one's full grown. And you know, in this residential area, it kind of poses some risks, you know. And this thing was smart. You could tell he'd been living here a while. He took me right around a piling. How is he wrapped? I almost want to jump in the water. Go and hook it.
So some way, somehow, I get this thing off the piling. But wouldn't you know, the next thing, I come tight to this fish, and he is directly underneath the camera boat. My luck.
Keep going. Just go right at him.
Okay. I'll tell you, this thing dragged us through the docks, had to open up the bail.
Smart fish around here. He lives in these canals, so he knows what to do.
We're at the tail end of the mullet run. This time of the year, we saw some mullet. Just every now and then a school mullet would go through this morning. And every time it happened, these tarpon would blow up on them.
Down and away. She goes right, you go left. She goes left, you go right.
You know, Bill tags a lot of these fish for research, and he was just saying, what, how old is this fish, you say?
45 to 50 years old, a fish that big.
45 to 50 years old. Now, you gotta think how long it took this fish to get this big. You wanna get him in as quick as you can, get a nice quick release, but man,
I'll
tell you
what. Probably 76, 78 inches long. See if you can bring her over this way.
Get her, Bill. There it is. What do you she's over 100.
Oh, yeah.
Feel that bone?
Yep.
Okay, she's yours now.
Oh. Okay, tip her up sideways. We'll get some good shots of her.
Let me just revive her. Look at that.
That's a big fish right there.
Yep.
That is full grown.
Mm-hmm.
Look at this mouth.
You put your head in that mouth. You did that? Yeah, that's good.
Good. Oh, there she goes.
Yes, there she goes.
Woo-hoo-hoo!
That beats a sharp stick in the eye, don't it?
Wow! Marco Island. Snook, tarpon. You can't beat this place.
Uh-uh.
I can't believe we got him out of there. He went around the piling. I was this close. I took my phone out of my pocket. I was getting the mic off. I was going to go in the water after that fish. There was no way he was getting away from me. He went around a piling.
Ran underneath another boat.
Underneath another boat. Whoo! And we got him.
And we got her.
Got her.
What a perfect day. All tarpon over 80 pounds are female.
Really?
Yeah. That's what the biologists say.
See this? I'm learning. I mean, I was a little concerned when you reached in there and grabbed him like that. Mm-hmm. You know, I was going to injure his gills, but you say that's what you do. You reach in. Yeah.
You lift the gill plate up and you reach in so you're above the gills and there's a bone in there that you can wrap your fingers around. And once you wrap your fingers around, you pretty much got control of it.
And you're not gonna do damage to the
fish that way.
You're
not gonna damage the gills because the gills are underneath. If you go through the gills, you'll kill them.
Okay. So that's important. You know, people stick gaps in their mouths, they do all these other things.
And tarpon are suction feeders. If you tear their jaw open, they won't eat for months till it heals if they don't starve to death first.
You know, we're just a hop, skip, and a jump away from the Marriott Resort where we're staying in Marco Island. We get back just in time, probably for what this area is so much famous for, is these sunsets, these beautiful Gulf Coast sunsets. We got to see that, went back, got cleaned up, headed over to the restaurant, had some great dinner and some great drinks.
This segment is brought to you by Yeti Coolers. Wildly stronger keeps ice longer.
In this week's seminar, I'm going to talk to you about the types of hooks that we chose to use in this episode, why we chose them. You know, we were fishing two different types of baits down here in 10,000 Islands. We were fishing white baits and we were fishing big mullet. You know, first off, I'm going to talk to you about the white baits. Personal preference for me is these small little J hooks from Trocar. This is a little 2-0 live bait hook, nice and strong, and it's a great sized hook for, you know, a 4 or 5 inch white bait. This is a perfect hook that I like to use. We were tying this to a 30 pound piece of fluorocarbon leader on light tackle. We were flipping it around structure. And it's a great hook for a white bait. Another thing that we were using was a big circle hook. Now this is a 9-0 Trocar circle hook. And this is a great hook to use when you're tarpon fishing. We were using mullet that were got anywhere from 8 inches to 14 inches long. And this is a perfect size hook for those size mullet. When I'm sitting there and I have a bait out the back and I'm just slow trolling along, this hook is gonna do just about everything. If I leave that reel in gear and just have that mullet on the surface, when that fish comes up and rolls, more times than not, these circle hooks are gonna catch the corner of the mouth for the tarpon and really improve your landing ratio.
You know, so the next morning we're pretty much, you know, we're zoned in, we're focused. We know where the fish were the day before. We're not gonna spend the time running further down to the south. We're gonna stick with this residential area where these fish were blowing up. You know, we were seeing tarpon the day before. We wanted to put our time in here this morning. We went and loaded up with some bait, headed back over to this area, and we kind of posted up looking for these snook and tarpon.
All right, morning two. We had a good day yesterday. Covered a lot of water, but I think the common denominator that we found yesterday was the fish were all in this residential area. So day two, we decided to come right back here. We're gonna fish some mullet, right?
Yeah, we're gonna try to do the same thing. You know, put some mullet out back, see if we can get another tarpon on.
A little more cloud cover this morning. Yesterday was bright bluebird skies, which is usually tough for fishing. But we got a front coming in tonight. You can kind of see it here. Conditions are changing. Hopefully they're gonna chew on this side of the front.
You know, we're kind of utilizing that same technique that we had the day before. We had some big mullet out the back on circle hooks. But you know, while you're just sitting there kind of, it's almost kind of a lazy type of fishing, we decide why not, you know, pitch some white baits right along the shoreline, right along the rocks, and look for some of those snook.
That might be a big snook.
What you got there, Bill?
We don't know yet. Told you there was some good snook around here.
Buddy, when you're tarpon fishing, we were just saying, if you use a big mullet, you have no idea what you're gonna catch.
Yep.
And that is a good one for over here.
I was saying to Bill, man, what's the chances of us getting a big snook doing that same thing? And he said it was there. Throw it there, you never know.
Look at that.
Right up along those walls.
There's everything in here feeding on these. That is a big West Coast snook right there.
Tarpon fishing, catch a big old snook.
Yep.
Whew. You know, after catching that quality snook, you know, the bite kind of had slowed down. The day was getting warm, you know, the sun was high. We decided to call it a day. We had caught plenty of fish. You know, this was a great trip down to the 10,000 Island section of the Florida Sportsman Forum, fishing in Marco Island. You know, we got a wonderful opportunity to stay at the Marriott Island Beach Resort here in Marco Island. You know, 5-star accommodations, treated us beautifully. Great restaurants, and hanging out with John and Bill, we got the best fishing in this area. We caught beautiful snook, you know, a giant tarpon, and I saw the best of Marco Island. It was my first trip down here. It won't be my last. It was because of John's, you know, post on the forum that I chose him to fish with. I need your reports to continue, so I may fish with you next on Real Time, Florida Sportsman.
They're gonna be tight on that bank, they're gonna be right on that drop-off.
Yeah, the drop-off, or on the bank.
Redneck kite fishing in the Everglades. What's that?
What?
Marco Island? 10,000 Islands?